Okay, so welcome to the fourth week of DocMath. And so the talk this morning will be given by Haruki Watanabe from the University of Tokyo. And he will tell us about a symmetry-based indicator of topology. So thank you, Haruki.
Yeah, thank you. I'd like to first thank Gregor for inviting me to this wonderful night workshop. And this is my first time to visit Paris. It's really a nice experience. Like, I didn't know that the city of Paris is so beautiful. And every buildings are like historic and old, and food are tasty. And I'm very happy to be here. And but you know, not only enjoying the travel in Paris. This is why I come here. So I think I have to give a talk. Okay. So today I'd like to talk about. So I changed my topic. I initially tell Gregor to talk about something else, but I decided to change my topic. So today I'd like to talk about some work done with my PhD advisor Ashwin Vishwanath and his student Adrian Hoi Chun Po. I'd like to mention that there are many people working on this topic. Not you know, our collaborators, but for example, Ken Shiozaki and Sato-san in Kyoto University, they are approaching to this problem using K-theory. Also, Chen Fang in China and his students are doing something related. And Andre Bernabig in Princeton, maybe coming to Germany, and also his group attacking this problem from a completely different, independent approach. So I don't want to like miss the proper citations to their paper. So let me first say, you know, it's not only us doing this, and there are many independent works going on, and this is like an actively developing field. Okay. So let me start my talk with saying, you know, explaining there are two roles, two relations between symmetry and topology, and usually what happens is that symmetry protects topology. Like the most famous example is quantum spin hole effect, in which time asymmetry protects the non-trivial say edge states. There's one edge state going this way, and the other edge state going that way, the other way, and because of the time asymmetry, that state is protected. There's another role between symmetry and topology, relation between symmetry and topology, that is symmetry detects topology. For example, so this is an illustration of spin model or 1D ring. So this is 1D ring, and I have spins. But now I'm putting a constraint that spin can only point in plane, okay? So these spins are all like, this is U1 degree of freedom, okay? It can only point in plane, not out of plane, okay? Then I have a map, like this is 1D ring, and I have 1D spins, U1 spins. So I can define a winding number, right? Then, for example, this configuration is winding number one. This configuration is winding number two. And suppose that I want to compute this winding number without literally following this spin texture. Then what I can do is the following. I can add some symmetry to this problem. For example, let me assume the rotation symmetry about this axis. Here, I'm assuming the pi rotation symmetry about this axis. Then spins at this point and this point are related by rotation symmetry. Then there are two special points in this problem, the two spins on the axis. And I can compute the rotation eigenvalues. That is I here and minus I here, I and I. And once I see that the two eigenvalues are different, then I can conclude that the winding number is odd. Namely, the spin configuration cannot be trivial. So that's what I mean by symmetry detects topology. There are a couple of special points, like high symmetry points in the problem. And looking at the symmetry eigenvalues at these two points, I can already conclude that the winding number should be non-trivial in this case. In this case, although the winding number is non-trivial, I cannot see that. Because you know what I can say is that winding number is have to be even. It can be zero. So I lose a lot of information in this way. But this is what I want to do in the bound theory.
So to define this eigenvalue, uh-huh. look at the single at just two spins.
Yeah, so that's the point. Yeah, just look at the high symmetry line, high symmetry point, and just compute the symmetry eigenvalues, and take compare them. If they are different, I already know that the winding number should be non-trivial. Yeah. And the most famous example of this phenomenon in band theory is the Fugain formula. And so, for example, we are interested in the D2 quantum spin Hall index. And if I have to compute it by following their very definition, it might require a careful gauge fixing, or the compute. I will have to compute the Puffian, right? But suppose I don't want to do that. Then again, we can add some symmetry. In this case, let's add inversion symmetry, right? Then this formula tells us that, okay, just multiply the all inversion parities at high symmetry momenta. Then if it is minus one, the quantum spin Hall index is non-trivial. If that is plus one, then quantum spin Hall index is trivial. So that's developed by Fu and Kane. And so in this case, because we have a Clemmas degeneracy, you have to, when you compute this index, you have to take only one from the Clemmas pair. But that's, I hope you kind of agree that, you know, this is really the same phenomenon. Just looking at high symmetry points and compute the parity eigenvalues, that's enough to tell us about the bound topology. Okay? Yeah, question?
Yes.
Yep.
I mean, you apply parity operator to a wave function.
Yep.
It is defined after a phase.
Uh-huh. So what I'm doing here is that we have a Bloch state and apply parity operator, and I get some eigenvalues. So Bloch wave function is defined only up to a phase, but you know, you can multiply the same number here. But the point here is that, you know, we are dealing with the point where k and minus k are the equivalent points, so there's no phase ambiguity here. Let's focus on the gamma point, like zero momentum. Then, like, this equation is well defined, right? Like, you can multiply phase to Bloch state, but you have to multiply the same phase here, so there's no phase ambiguity.
Clear?
Or?
I trust you, but I don't understand.
Oh my god, okay. I mean, we say there's a phase ambiguity. For example, if we introduce some phases here, right? And if it changes eigenvalues, then we say it's ill-defined. For example, if this is time reversal operation, I want to still talk about this kind of relation. But if I multiply phase factor here and here, it changes the eigenvalues. Because it is anti-unitary operation, they don't cancel in the left-hand side and right-hand side. But in this case, because this is unitary operation, the eigenvalue is a well-defined concept. Yeah, we can chat later, yeah. Other questions?
So
yeah.
So now you've identified mm-hmm. the symmetry point,
mm-hmm.
and then what is the statement that you can find the Chern number?
Yes. So here, I have an inversion operator and Bloch state, and I have an eigenvalue xi at gamma point 0. And this xi can be either plus 1 or minus 1. That is followed by the fact that inversion square is plus 1. So eigenvalue is either plus 1 or minus 1. And then here, I'm showing you the inversion parity of the occupied band. And the reason why we have two of the same one is that, you know, we have Clemmas degeneracy, and time-asymmetry and inversion symmetry commutes. So the, you know, the two states in the Clemmas degeneracy have to have the same inversion parity. So this is a kind of one example of inversion configuration. And the statement is that multiply this inversion parity. If that minus one, then that is Z2 quantum spin Hall index. So if it is minus one, spin hole in, quantum spin hole insulator. If that's plus one, trivial insulator. So, you know, this kind of topology is usually the property of the bound structure of the entire Brillouin zone, right? Like, in order to diagnose the topology, in principle, you have to see the entire Brillouin zone. But in this case, this formula reduces the information to this only high symmetry point. So that's nice, I mean. It's easy to compute.
What I don't understand is, mm-hmm.
Yeah, so in this case, we have only two choices. We know the classification of this choice, this phase, that's we have only translation symmetry and time asymmetry. So we know the classification is Z2. Mm-hmm. And this also gives you Z2 thing. Okay. Yeah. So this actually, in this case, it's complete. Yeah.
But in general,
it's not. Yeah. This example, sorry.
Right.
This example shows that, you know, it's like a very partial classification. Yeah, it's a really important point, thanks. And what I'd like to do in this talk is that, okay, this is a very nice example, but it's like a combination of invariant eigenvalues, diagnosis or indicates that, you know, Z2 quantum spin hole index. So what I'd like to do is that, in general, not only invariant symmetry, we want to use more symmetries that can exist in a crystal. So combination of representations at high symmetry momenta indicates some topology, not necessarily quantum spin hole index. Okay, so there are a variety of symmetries in crystals, and there are a variety of topology in the bound structure, right? So we'd like to extend this formula to that kind of like wider class. So that's what I want to do in this talk. Is it clear? And before going to the very specific things about band topology, I'd like to talk about the definition of topological insulators. Okay, so there are many criterion about, you know, when this insulator should be called topological, and I think the most convenient or used, frequently used one is the presence of protected edge states. What? Yeah.
So. You have this high symmetry momenta,
yep.
And in general, so I'm a little confused as to if you're going to assume a crystal structure,
yep.
And then you're going to look at sort of crystalline topological insulators.
Sure.
That's what you're
yeah,
assume a crystal structure, and that's part of the symmetry.
Yes. So we first assume some symmetry, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you can define some topological numbers given this symmetry class. So it can be topological crystal insulators. It can be original Z2 quantum spin hole insulators, which doesn't require crystal symmetry. So the topology class I'm interested in are like a kind of everything. I want to, in principle, I want to diagnose all possible phases.
So in the simple Z2 case with,
yep.
Kane Fu,
yep.
you assumed there had to be inversion symmetry in order to use this formula.
Mm-hmm.
And so is this actually a statement about?
Yeah, so I guess the question here is that, okay, so we have some symmetry. And the part of the symmetry is used to protect phases. So for example, in that case, inversion symmetry combined with time asymmetry. In that case, time asymmetry protects the phases, Z2 quantum spin hole phases. And the latter, the other part of the symmetry is only used to diagnose the phases.
Okay.
Yeah. But so in general, if I assume like larger class of symmetry, this distinction is kind of ambiguous. But still, we can tell, you know, which part protects the phase and which part is used to diagnose the phases. And that really depends on specific space group we are interested in. So there are many patterns. But yeah, exactly. That's what I'm going to do from now.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, so yeah, before going to the detail, I have to define, you know, what is non-trivial in this problem. And I am saying that there are three criterion that, you know, an insulator can be called topological. The first one is presence of edge states. You know, we compute band structure with open boundary condition and compute band structure, and if there's a mid-gap state that cannot be eliminated, protected by symmetry, then we say the band regulator is topological. And the other definition is that if we can define some non-trivial winding number, say Chan number or the quantum spin Hall index, we might say the insulator is non-trivial. And but the third definition, actually, this is what I'm going to use in this talk, is that we can ask whether it is possible to adiabatically deform the insulator to a product state. So the trivial state in the discussion of topological insulator is a product state. It's like a tight binding model without any hopping. And can we adiabatically connect the insulator to that? So actually, this definition can also apply to the definition of trivial state in the classification of SPT. So even if you include all interaction effects, you can still use this definition to classify phases, right? So I'd like to use this. And the point here is that all of these three definitions are different. Usually people say it's kind of equivalent, but that's not the case. So I will give you an example of the insulator which have obstruction connecting to atomic insulator, but still it doesn't have any edge state or strong winding number. Okay. Any questions? Can we proceed? Yeah. Okay. So let me first formulate how do I derive some relation between how to characterize band structure using representations. So this is a kind of like a band structure I can easily find in the condensed matter textbook. And it says it illustrates the band structure along high symmetry points or lines. For example, in this case, I have gamma point and the K point, and this is a band structure connecting gamma to K. And the level like sigma 1, sigma 2 here, is a symmetry level. So, you know, at each point, it's a complicated symmetry group. And the symmetry group depends on the momentum. So gamma point and K point have different symmetry. And there are many different representations. For example, gamma point, I have gamma 1, gamma 1, 5, gamma 1, like that, right? So let me focus on some set of bands isolated from other bands, at least at high symmetry points. So And what I want to do is to count the number of representations used in each point. For example, at the gamma point, this band structure uses only gamma 1, 5 representations, and it doesn't use gamma 1 representation or gamma 1, 2 representation. So that kind of information I'd like to keep to characterize band structure. Okay? At sigma point, symmetry line, I have 2 sigma 1 representations and 1 sigma 2 representation. So it's easy, right? Just for every momentum, we just count the number of representations, irreducible representations, at that point. Okay. And if I'm focusing on this band, I will not count the number of representations at other bands. Okay. So more precisely, what I'm doing is that first, I collect all different types of momentum, high symmetry momentum. Like it can be points, lines, or planes. And for each momentum, I define a little group, GK. That is a symmetry operation that doesn't change K up to, like say, like a crystal momentum. Then I list up the all possible irreducible representations, UK alpha. Here, alpha is the level of the representation. And then count the number of times UK alpha appears in the given band structure. And I'm going to form a very long vector, which I call B. The entry of this vector is given by this, you know, NK and alpha. So this can be a very long vector. Okay. So is this definition clear? Like given band structure, look at many different momentum and count the number of irreducible representations appearing in this set of band structure. Okay, and what I want to stress is that these integers cannot be chosen arbitrarily. For example, let me go back to one slide. So here, for example, every time you see gamma 1, 5 here, then you always see 2 sigma 1 and 1 sigma 2. See, like for example, in this line, right? 1 gamma 1, 5 here, and 2 sigma 1, and 1 sigma 2. So there are relations between representations, and the integer have to satisfy all of such kind of relationship called compatibility relations. And there are many different types of compatibility relations. But you know, that's something we can deal with. And we form the set of all valid combination of integers. We call this set a bound structure space. This is like a general, just a set of the integers that kind of characterize a bound structure. Okay.
So
yes.
Are number of representations, is that correct?
Yeah.
For each of the points.
Yeah. For example, in this case, I would call so gamma n for this representation is 1 because it is used, and n for this representation is 0 because it's not used in this set of bands. So we have to first decide which of the band we use. So for example, let's focus on these three bands, and then for each point I count it, and that number is just n. It has a level of momentum k and representation alpha. Yes.
So I guess if you have a line or a plane, a constant over the whole manifold.
Yeah. So I have to count it. First, I have to pick only one representative point out from the line, and count the number. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
And again, can you go back to the slide before?
This one.
So yes, this vector is associated to. I'm not sure whether it's defined for the whole band or just 1k.
So yeah, thanks. So I have two indices, k and alpha, right?
Yeah.
So I have to vary all different k and all different alpha. So it's like it starts from k1 and alpha 1, alpha equal 1, k1, alpha equal 2, and exhaust all alpha, then different k, and different alphas. So this is going to be really long, but it's kind of characterized the representations in the band. I mean, in practice, this is not really long. I mean, but if you formulate this problem really in a formal manner, it's the could be really long.
And are all the constraints coming from local in K space? Like if I have a gamma? No.
So there are several different types of constraints, and the one I explained here is certainly local, as you said. And the non-local global constraint comes from a non-symmorphic operation. If you have a non-symmorphic symmetry, it's all about like topology of the Brillouin zone, like glide operation, eigenvalue changes as you go across the Brillouin zone. And yeah, there is a global constraint as well. Okay. And then, okay, so far I'm kind of explaining, you know, what is the integers that can appear in general in the bound structure, right? So I have to judge if that combination is trivial or non-trivial. So let me explain, you know, which combination is non-trivial. And that is given by atomic insulator, okay? So here, I'm illustrating here is this is a real space picture. And I have, for example, s orbital sitting in the origin of the init cell. Okay, so this is trivial states. And I consider a tight-band model of these trivial states, but no hopping. So this is really a flat-band model. And since this is a product state in real space, this is really trivial. But in some sense, I'd like to say that, you know, this is the same as 1E orbitals. So if you can form 1E orbital, 1E orbital have some 1E center, right? And 1E orbital do not hop each other. So it's really similar to atomic orbitals. So, but basically, the product states or some bound insulator that can have 1E description. So these two are the same thing. It's really topologically trivial. Okay. So this is a definition of topological trivial state. But actually, there are several different types of trivial states. So for example, let's look at inversion symmetric 2D model. So this here, I'm assuming inversion symmetry, and this is two-dimensional sphere lattice. Then there are special points in real space, like this point x is maps to minus x. And so origin, or center of bond, or center of the initial, these are all special points, right? And at special points, I have symmetry, inversion symmetry. So I can talk about representation of this inversion symmetry. That can be plus one or minus one, like s orbital or p orbital, right? So I have a choice of atomic initiators, where I put orbital and which representation we use. And so this is like a, sorry, this is kind of difficult to get, but this is like a combination of real space and momentum space. So I'm here explaining that, you know, depending on where you put your orbital and which orbital you use, the representation in momentum space can be different. So gamma point is 0, 0, x point is pi 0. This is the momentum space picture. And I'm showing to you here is the parity eigenvalues in momentum space. So if I use s orbital as the origin in real space, the symmetry representation in momentum space is all plus, 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 plus. However, if I use if I put s orbital in the center of the bond, then the representation can be minus. Okay, and I explain why. So I start from the case s orbital in the origin, then momentum 0, 0 means I have the same orbital everywhere. So I have plus eigenvalues. If I have momentum pi 0, then that means that if I proceed in x direction, the wave function alters the phase. So minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, plus 1. Still, if I perform inversion operation, the eigenvalue is plus 1, right? Because the picture comes back to itself. However, if I place my s orbital in the center of the bond, the station is different. So this is k, momentum k equals 0, 0, so everything is the same. However, if my momentum is pi 0, the wave function changes sign as I go one step in x direction. Then if I perform inversion operation at the center of the bond, center of the unit cell, no, this is where. This is the origin of the unit cell. Then the wave function switches the sign phase. So this means the eigenvalues is minus 1. Yes, it depends. So what I have to do is, first, I have to fix my operation. Where is the inversion center? And what's the, yeah.
The relative phase, I guess, between this k 0, 0 and k pi 0.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but
for the same operation.
Sure, but not only relative phase. I want to say that, you know, the definite phase is also well defined if you fix your operation. Yeah, but you are right. If you
these are two different operations.
Yeah, exactly.
One is centered around vertex, the other.
Sure. But that's how I get this list. Okay, depending on the position or depending on your orbital, I can okay. All these all correspond to flat band, right? So it looks really trivial. They are all equally look trivial, but you know the representation contents are different. Okay. But now I already you know set up, right? So this is a general set of representations that can appear in band structure, and this is a set of representations that can appear in atomic initiators. So what I can do is to compare these two sets, and if they are different, then I can tell which band structure is non-trivial. So that's what I'm going to do from now. So I have band initiator space, which is a set of integers that can appear in general in a band structure. And atomic initiator space is vector representations that correspond to atomic initiators like this. You know, I have 8 different combinations here. Okay. And basically, what I'm doing is to compare these two sets and take quotient. I compare them, and then If they are different, then I would say they are non-trivial combinations. So like, this is what happens. So I have some integers. So these integers is like a, you know, B vector is like a set of integers. So it's like a lattice structure in imaginary space. Like, you know, this is not original lattice structure. It's like a, you know, set of integers that can appear in the bound structure. And I'm comparing it against the combination of representations that appear in lattice atomic initiators. So this is a trivial combination, and I'd like to identify them. So I identify this point with this point, this point. If I do that, then I will get Z2 cross Z2 classification in this case. Like, I identify this point with this point, but this point and this point are different. So I get Z2 cross Z2 classification, okay? But my point is that I can apply this technique of classifying representations to all possible space groups, right? So
what were the
pairs again? Yeah. So here I explained, you know, what is a B, right? So that's the combination, that's integer n k alpha in general for bound structure. I restrict myself to atomic initiators, that's A. Oh, I see. So, yeah. Okay, so great. That's a really important question. So, in the definition, this bound structure space uses integer n. That cannot be negative, right? It must be non-negative integers. But now I'm extending these integers to negative values so that I can have the structure of Abelian group. So, I mean, there are many possible ways of comparing these two. For example, the easiest way you can do is like you don't need bound group structure at all, and take the group just compare these two like this way.
You just remove the A.
Remove a atomic initiator. Then what remains have to be topological. And that this process does not require any subtraction. So this can be well defined even without introducing group structure. Namely, you know, you don't have to extend the possible values of integer n to negative number.
Yeah, but in your example, there would be a lot more stuff left than four. If you just, so you had your example with
mm-hmm.
the Galton picture
kind of. Oh, yeah.
This one?
Exactly, yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's important. But
you just remove the A.
Yeah, so this is really related to K theory, right? Like what is we are classifying? Like K theory type classification always allows us to do subtraction or addition of the trivial bands. Then we can at the end we will get some classification like a ZN type results. That is because we do negative things. If you don't do that, then the classified result will not be a simple Abelian group. And we have a choice at this stage, you know, what we want to do. And I'm kind of following here the idea of K theory. So that's why I extend them to Abelian group and take quotient. But yeah, it's like a classifying vector bundle itself will be different from K theory type classification. The same thing here. Now that's a really important point.
And how did you define what was the atomic insulator? What was the definition there?
Oh, this thing. So what I have to do is that. So actually, I didn't cite the book I'm using, but there's a cool book called International Tables for Crystallography. And in that book, you can find the list of special points in real space and the symmetry group of that position. So what we did is to list up all atomic insulators by reading the book. You know, OK, here's the special point, and here's the symmetries. So that defines the orbital types at these positions. And I kind of exhausted all possible atomic insulators.
Okay.
Yeah.
Product state.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just a product state.
Yep.
So then you classify all the basis of that material
mm-hmm.
in momentum space,
mm-hmm.
You build this B vector, which
yep.
is really now you call it an A vector, and then you is that correct? Is that what you call an A vector? So the B vector for the trivial state.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay.
B vector for trivial state. That's precisely what I call A.
Right,
yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So the B vector for trivial state, and then by comparing these two in
yeah.
some way, which is not clear to me,
oh, okay.
you're
so
saying you can get
yeah, so yeah, exactly. So let me explain one slide I skipped. So here, you notice that you know, this is a representation in the momentum space, and if I take products, it's all plus one, right? So every time you see minus sign, I have to have another minus sign. So atomic insulator have that property. For example, this is inversion symmetric 2D model. Atomic insulator, in the case of atomic insulator, if I take products of all parity eigenvalues at 4 points, it always plus one. But in general, like Chan insulator, so this is like a Chan insulator. I have negative sign at the gamma point, and all plus signs at other points. So this is product is minus one. So this combination can never be obtained as an atomic insulator. So there's a difference between atomic insulator and atomic insulator. If they are different, I already know that you know this can never be adiabatically connected to any atomic insulator because the representation does not match. So that's what I want to do. And this quotient part is just a, you know, what depends on what we want to do part. Like first, I extend these integers to negative values to have the structure of abelian group. You know, like just 0, 1, 2, 3 doesn't have a abelian group structure, right? But if I have minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, then I have an abelian group. Like addition is a group operation.
Is there an assumption here or that you are keeping the same lattice symmetries?
Oh, yes. Yeah, so all of these business have to be done for each space group. So first, fix your group, you know, like inversion symmetry in two dimension, or like a four-fold rotational symmetry in three dimension, things like that.
Are you then classifying topological states, or are you classifying the symmetry protected by some?
Yes, so I'd like to handle all of them. It can be topological topological crystalline state. It can be just a quantum spin Hall state or Z2 strong quantum Hall state.
But I would think that I mean, if you're just classifying general topological states,
mm-hmm.
you should be allowed to also say change the symmetry of the lattice as long as you can deform.
Why? I thought the classification wise, what we want to do is that first fix your symmetry. And what we are asking, what is allowed phases given this symmetry setting? So we never change symmetry itself. Good.
Well, I could be confused by definitions of
what is symmetry. Oh, is that
right? Yeah,
but let me clarify, you know, my point. So what I want to do is first fix the symmetry class, like this space group. And possibly time as a symmetry or not, you know, we have to first fix it, and then ask how many different topological crystalline insulators or topological insulators are there, and what is the relation between that topological state to the representations? Okay, that's the question. Yeah. Yes.
Let me ask the same question
yeah.
just a second ago because I understood it. Now after that answer, I think I don't. So, in order to find all of the trivial insulators, the atomic
mm-hmm.
insulators.
Mm-hmm.
You have to put atoms at all the high symmetry points in real space.
Yeah.
In all possible ways.
Yeah.
So they transform in all possible ways, and you did that at all points, and that gives you everything you can get.
Yes. So in this case, I have to deal with this 1.1234,
yeah.
and the generic point. Reduces to special points, so I don't have to talk about the generic points.
Sure.
But in principle, there can be more. Like for example, the symmetry group of honeycomb lattice, that can be a symmetry group of triangle lattice and Hagomi lattice, right? So then I have to try all possible, say Hagomi, triangular lattice, Hagomi, honeycomb lattice,
and put S orbital or three, you know, the point is, say, for example, six-fold rotation symmetric, then I have to place many different orbitals there. And I list up all possible atomic insulators. And I compare this set against the band insulator I'm interested in.
So when you do that, I mean, you show that you can get, by looking at the symmetry transformation of all the possible points, you can mm-hmm. get a situation where the product of the minus signs is actually minus one.
Mm-hmm.
But you would not have counted this by putting single orbitals at single points. That would never have come off.
Now you're talking about the negative
next
integer issue?
On the next slide. So you have this list, and these all you magically, they all multiply to plus one.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And then the next slide, you have one that multiplies to minus two. Yeah, here, this one multiplies to minus one.
Yeah, yeah.
And you say that you would never get this one by just putting in atomic orbitals. And that's why you...
Exactly, yeah, precisely, yeah. So what I'm suggesting is, so this is the band structure I'm interested in, for example. And I'm suggesting to try all possible atomic insulators that is consistent with symmetry. So I don't have to restrict myself to these four points. Like you know, it can be like very, you know, as I said, in the case of wallpaper group number 17, I have to try all possible atomic insulators that can be centered at triangle lattice, honeycomb lattice, Kagome lattice, many different representations. And if they are different, then I can safely conclude that this must be topological. Okay, so let me explain what I get. So, like, you know, as I said, you know, we can just automatically compute these things by using Mathematica. And for example, this is what I get. So, for inversion symmetric, time answer symmetric 3D model, I got Z2 cross Z2 cross Z2 cross Z4 result. And let me explain to you the interpretation of this. So first three indices are weak TI. So like you know, I can have a topological insulator in XY plane and stack them together. That gives you one Z2, and I can do the same thing for other planes. Okay, but the last Z4 factor was kind of confusing to us because we thought you know this is like a strong TI, but strong TI we know that it must be Z2, so we didn't know what is indicated in here. And then the answer was given in this nice paper by Chen Fang, they found that this is actually related to a higher order topological insulator. And I will come back to this point in a few slides, so let me proceed. Another setting is that same symmetry group, inversion symmetry and time-answer symmetry, inversion symmetry, but without time-answer symmetry in three dimension. Then I will get the same answer, Z2, 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 Z4, but in this case, what you get is a wild symmetry. So generator of this group is actually looks like this. You have plus eigenvalues everywhere in kz equals 0 plane and one minus eigenvalue at kz equals pi plane. In this case, the Chan number in kz equals 0 plane and kz equals pi plane must be different. It's even and odd. So there must be some wild point in between. So like in this case, you have necessary gapless points in the interior of Brian zone that is enforced by the representation combinations. Okay. So what I'm saying is that our method not only classifies these you know insulators, but it can also classify or have some statement on semi-metals as well. And what is important to us is that you know we have a band gap at all high symmetry points. Otherwise, we cannot count the number of representations. So in this case, the high symmetry points are all 8 points at the corner, right? So here we have a band gap so that we can count the number of representations. But then this set of representations indicates that the band gap closes somewhere in the interior of the Brillouin zone. So that's what we can tell from these representations. Okay. And so in this Z2, 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 Z4 case, the first Z2 is really a Chan insulator. So I have a stacked Chan insulator. And then as I explained, this combination is wild symmetry. So this is the generator of this Z4 thing. And And suppose I have two copies of this. So since I have a y symmetry, like this, like I have a y point here. If I have two copies of this, I can gap out the system. So I have two y points here, and they can gap out, and I will get insulator. But what I'm saying here is that because the classification is Z4, not Z2, the two copies of this is still non-trivial. And I will get a high order TI here in this case. And I want to explain why. So before going to explaining why, I have to first explain what is high order TI. So this is an illustration of real space picture of the system. So this is like a material cut it in the shape of sphere, okay? So usually people say if the material is topological, it has to have gapless surface. But in this case, it doesn't have surface state, a gapless surface state. Instead, it has a residual, like one-dimensional gapless mode, say in this case at the equator, okay? And in this case, this is really simple. You know, at the beginning of the talk, I explained that, you know, looking at inversion parities, we can talk about, we can judge the quantum spin hole index, right? In three dimension, suppose we have time asymmetry. Then I take one from the Kramer's pair and multiply them together. If that minus one, that's topological insulator. But then if we apply magnetic field breaks the time asymmetry, so it opens a gap at the surface Dirac mode. But then, you know, if I have cubic geometry and I have Dirac cones, topological insulators, and apply magnetic field to gap out this Dirac cone, then I can regard this plane as sigma equal 1/2 quantum hole spin hole quantum hole state, and this one is also a quantum spin hole state, but sigma equal plus 1 in this normal plane direction. That means that if I take the normal direction to the going out direction to the sphere, then the sigma xy is plus 1/2 here and minus 1/2 here. So there must be a domain wall of the Chan number. So that is given by this chiral edge mode. So you know, there's a kind of simple picture why, in this case, we get higher order topological insulator. And for this time asymmetric case, we will get higher order topological insulator with a helical edge mode. It depends on the setting. You know, you have many different types of 1D edge mode. And so this is the two examples, our familiar inversion symmetric case. But we can continue doing this for many symmetric group. And here, I'm explaining a new topological phases we identified. But for this, I have to come back to this picture. So I said I compare combinations in band structure against combination that can be realized at the atomic insulator. And if we take quotient, we lose all important some important information. So let me, in this case, just compare the representations itself. Okay. So here, I'm giving an example of tight binding model defined on Honeywell lattice. Okay. So this is just a definition. Okay. So I have two orbitals, two sites in unit cell, and on each side we have spin up electron and spin down electron. So this is in total four band model. And what we know is that, you know, okay, like Fouquet model on Honeywell lattice, if we have a band gap in between two band below and two band up, we will realize a non-trivial Z2 quantum spin hole insulator. So that's what we know for the usual model, tight binding lattice model on Honeywell lattice, right? But in this case, we designed a model in a very special manner, such that each of these two bands does not have Z2 quantum spin hole index. So these are trivial. Still, this upper two bands have an obstruction to connect to any atomic limit. Although this lower two band can be adiabatically connected to triangular lattice atomic limit. So this is a very complicated, but it's very actually a simple. Like what we did is to cook up some model such that lower two bands have the same representation as atomic insulator defined on triangular lattice side. But then this upper two bands does not have a representation that can be compatible with any atomic limit. So just by looking at the representations used in this this upper two bands, we know that this must be topological. While these lower two bands, we really confirmed that we can form a one-year orbital. So this is like a picture of one-year orbital. So it is defined on honeycomb lattice, but the one-year center is on the triangular lattice side. And this one-year orbital really decays exponentially. So it's really localized one-year orbital. So this is the profile of the one-year orbital. What is special here is that, you know, usually if we start from a four-band model, split it into two and two, usually what happens is that if lower two-band is trivial, upper two-band is also trivial. And if lower two-band is non-trivial, then this is also non-trivial. That's the usual case. But here, we managed to realize a situation where only lower two-band is trivial and upper two-band are non-trivial. So this is really a kind of special. And we call it fragile topology because the reason why we call it fragile topology is that, you know, this non-triviality of upper two bands can be trivialized by adding these trivial bands. So this is different from usual, say, Chan insulator. If I have Chan number one band, if I add many, you know, bands, trivial bands, this Chan number is stable, right? Chan number cannot be modified by adding trivial bands. But here, if I combine these two bands, these in total four bands, then this is just the all bands. So all bands have to be trivial. But
this is a bit different from the situation which K theory.
Exactly. So that's the point. So here I'm using this subtraction. I don't know how to say it. This like just comparing two sets picture. So I don't allow for negative integers. Then I can diagnose these kind of things. K theory can never see these kind of things because it extend to say negative numbers. Yeah, so it's not. This is not like stable classification. This is like a fragile classification. Yeah. But I think I'm running out of time. But I wanted to explain. You know, this question of classifying all possible representations can be done for many different symmetric settings. Like, for example, there are many space groups. Like, you know, there are 1651 magnetic space groups. Also, like internal symmetry, there are like 10 different internal symmetries. So far, I explained to you only class A and A1 and A2, which is with or without type of symmetry. So for magnetic space group, we can do something similar. And we got this like long table. And also for other internal symmetry classes, this is still ongoing work, also a student of Masaki. And we are classifying things. And I mean, I can explain more, but I don't think I'm now feeling hungry. So I guess we can stop here. So. if you're interested, I can discuss more. But so as a summary, you know, there are many different symmetry group settings, and okay, we had a nice formula of Fugain theorem, right? So we extended that to in this talk I covered 230 space groups, and I said, you know, we can compute to magnetic space groups. Possibly we can do AZ symmetry ten or all of the 10 AZ symmetry classes, but not sure. I mean, if the ultimate goal is complete classification of these things, like it looks like there are many different settings, and important things are already done, and the remaining symmetry classes are kind of complicated, and not sure if it's worth doing that, but that's something which we can definitely do. And I think for the condensed matter purpose, what is more important is to find materials. So what I hope is that, you know, this technology of diagnosing topology using representation can be implemented very easily to the first principle calculation. So what I suggest is that, you know, just compute, every time you compute band structure, just compute the representations. And then just look at the representation, you can easily judge if this is topological or non-topological. And yeah, I didn't explain that, but okay, that's super easy for us, but may not be easy for someone who are not familiar with representations.
We actually need just a code, program code,
uh-huh,
to do this classification automatically.
Yeah.
Is it possible to write down an algorithm?
Yeah, yeah, that's what we are doing, so,
okay.
Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, I kind of agree that, you know, developing that kind of code is not a straightforward thing because, yeah, I mean, we use a couple months to really code that, right? So, yeah, ideally we have to like kind of set develop some like database or something like that, so that you can easily
comp- why do you need a database?
Because, I mean, first you perform calculation and get combination of representations. And you have to judge, determine if this combination is interesting, topological. If yes, which kind of topology if you know, this combination indicates, like just a TI or TCI or high order TI, you have to judge it. It might be also possible that you know, this combination is not interesting at all. So you have to judge this thing, right?
Yeah.
And we kind of, in our laptop, we have some like a program, you know, judging that. But if you're just writing that code, you have to at least spend a couple months. So
yeah, of course. But
how
to do that? Then you can, let's say,
mm-hmm,
automatically or some in a straightforward way. I think you can do that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not. I mean, we try to explain how to do it in the paper. So hope you don't have to use the same effort as we did. It should be easy. Yeah, I think that's the end of my talk. So.
You mentioned for the bees there are some constraints.
What constraint?
Yeah, on the bees. Like,
ah, yeah. Yeah, that's a really good question. The answer is yes, and so recently Chen Fan and his student tried all possible layer constructions to actually find all possible all examples of indicators. So, you know, they found at least one example corresponding to an indicator. So that's kind of answers to your question. And but please note that, you know, sometimes the phase is gapless, like I showed here. Some combination representation indicates the gapless phase in which the band gap closes at generic momentum. Yeah.
Find some set of representations that are not compatible with the atomic insulator.
Yeah, yeah.
You have also some kind of automatic way or to tell something about what is special in the spectrum. In terms
You have to judge. You know, yeah, what is indicated, right? Like, is it weak phase or is it like high order TI phase or you know, yeah. So that thing. It's still true that you have to work out, and we have a table in the paper to say, okay, if this is an indicator, it must be this phase. So, yeah, I mean, yeah, one thing you can do is just read our paper and try to see the correspondence, but yeah, it may not be easy. that easy. I mean, yeah. So yeah, I'm kind of hoping to have better presentation. You know, like a nice looking database or I don't know something you can easily use. So far, yeah, we just have a paper and big tables.